am the team captain and the drive coach or the strategist for Team 1678. Richard?
Yeah, I'm Richard McCann. I'm a mentor with the team leading the scouting and strategy one part, and then business and media I'll be presenting with Brooke, who walked out presentation later today.
So how long have you been scouting, Richard?
I've been scouting since 2012. I got involved in working with the team at that time when my son was a senior, and I just kept on doing it. Unfortunately, my son enjoyed scouting as well, so the two of us worked together for about 3 years, and now he's working with a couple of teams down in San Jose.
All right, so we're going to talk about how to create a scouting system, from the math and what to scout for, all the way through the logistics of the technology and how to put that together.
So we begin with the fact that Brad Pitt is on our scouting team. You all know who Brad Pitt is from, you've been in the grocery
right there.
Store. Yeah, and you've been, and you know his picture with Angelina. They've been at the top of the thing. So Brad, he takes out time from being on People magazine to scout for. But actually the real story is we have how many of you have seen the movie Money Bots? Any of you?
What?
None of you. This is like, not nobody, you have to go see Money Bots, because that movie basically tells you how you use statistics in order to do better in sports and competitions, and that's basically what we're doing here. So that's what we call it, Money Ball, I should say.
Money Ball's the real.
Sorry, we changed it to Money Bots. So, next slide. Actually, you can sit there and put
hang
the slide. So I'm just going to go through a quick overview. I'm going to describe kind of the high level part of the scouting system, and then Brighton's going to take on the technical nuts and bolts parts that I know nothing about. So next slide. Like that. So we're in terms of our principles that we have that we use in looking at this. Next slide. Or next. Pop up. What we're doing is trying to combine quantitative and qualitative data that otherwise is overlooked in looking for values in particular robots. So we're looking for both attributes that we might be competing against, and how we want to use our alliance mates in a match, and then finally how we do our draft list in the end. And this is, as I mentioned, this actually is coming from something called sabermetrics.
And image is just
saber tiger.
Yeah.
And so this particular technique was developed for baseball. Baseball is full of statistics, and there's been a big movement since the 70s to use statistics in depth. And so we're building on that. The next slide. It's trying hard. So some of the objectives that we have in terms of our scouting system. We're looking for alliance mates that have specific types of attributes that we think are complementary to the way our robot performs. And we think about this from very early on in the design process. And then within matches themselves, we look for different match strategies that play either on the strength of our alliance mates or try to play on the weaknesses of our opponents. And that, this has all helped really well. I'm going to take a slight digression. How many of you know about what an OPR is? One person? It's the offensive power rating. You'll see the statistics sometimes reported at the competition. If you have the app Blue Alliance will report the OPRs of the teams as they're competing through the competition. What it gives you is some sense of the relative offensive output of the different robots that are in the match. Some years it works well, other years it doesn't. For example, this 2016 game, the OPR actually isn't that accurate at measuring the relative strength. There's two other metrics that are thrown out. Contribution to win margin and defensive power rating. These statistics actually are meaningless statistics. I won't go into the music.
Can I just interrupt a second?
Just ignore them.
Sorry.
Yeah.
There's you guys at the door, there's seats back here if you want to come sit down, so you don't have to like sit there craning your necks.
This is Braylon, who just walked in. Hi, my name's Braylon.
I'm going to see right here.
Welcome.
Nice.
You haven't missed much yet.
So one thing, as I mentioned, there is some correlation. I'm not going to go into how the OPR might relate to your scouting system. Generally, the OPR and your door correlate strongly. It's a useful proxy for scouting data. If you don't use the scouting data, you can use that as a back methodology to test how you use the rules of what your scouting system is giving up. slide. So we start the year by basically moving into analyzing the game. We do this from day one. We actually don't do any design of our robot for the first 3 days of the building. We're thinking about the game, and one part of this is thinking about what we get out of that thought process before we start to put into our scouting. We're looking for basically the union of strategy and scouting in that process at the start. And what our strategy is what dictates what we're scouting for. So, for example, in the game this year, we were looking at questions about whether robots are shooting high goals or low goals. We really wanted to go after high goal robots for our alliances, or whether they had a scaling capability at the end, so it would be a bonus 10 points. Those were certain things that we were trying to identify in our scouting system in this year. And there's other types of things that we scouted for in the past, so like 2014, which was, I think, fairly unique, was how we were scouting for the ability of robots to inbound balls into the game. So that was actually a key attribute that we were scouting for quite closely. So we were looking for all of the valuable robot actions. Inbounding was one that I talked about. That was where you all have heard about cheese kicking. That's kind of where we really started beginning the idea of trying to help other teams enhance their robots so that they can do particularly active attributes. And so we would scout for those sorts of things. And what we're doing is we're looking for, in the first case, a robot that scores in a way that complements the way that we score, so we're not competing with each other. And then identifying for the second robot in our alliance the kinds of supplementary roles that we're not covering with our robots. So next slide. We start by reading the rule book. We actually have a rules test for all of our team members on the first day. They have to pass the rules test in order to see working on the strategy and et cetera for the robot, because strategies that are illegal don't help you because they won't work. We had to know, for example, in 2014, what an assist was. It turned out it was actually kind of a very subtle rule that a lot of teams overlooked when they started designing their robots. And then you also want to understand some of the attributes of rankings and what the tiebreakers are in the rankings. So one of the things that you'll notice is over the last several years that we actually have focused a lot on what is the first tiebreaker and scoring very high in that one component. So that's why, for example, we focus on the autonomous routine, because the autonomous points are very often a tiebreaker in the ranking system. And it's actually a couple times it's gotten us higher in the ranking by having that tiebreaker. And you also need to understand that winning by a lot doesn't help your seeding order. Winning by 1 point helps your seeding order. Winning at the same as winning by 100 points. So focusing on these other ranking aspects rather than big scores is really what we focus on in our strategy system. Next slide. So you're looking for an efficient match strategy. That's what you're really trying to get out of the alliance that you're working with. So you want to consider all the different ways that you can score points. So we really focused in 2014, for example, on the assist points, trying to get that second assist, which was actually worth an additional 20 points. A lot of teams were missing. Capturing and breaching. In 2016, we have focused a lot on trying to get those extra ranking points, capturing and breaching in this game, as much as possible. And then you look at the difficulty of scoring points versus the points that are awarded. So some years there's in 2015, we actually decided not to go for a sixth tote on top because it actually added too much difficulty to the way that we were approaching our strategy. So we only went with a five tote high stack as our main strategy. So that was really, you need to think about those trade-offs and actually do the math in the scoring system as you're going forward. And then you're scouting, again, you're designing to look for scouting that's trying to complement these attributes. Next slide. And then there's defense. It's de-scoring. So 10 points less is worth as much to you as 10 points more in most cases. So you want to look at how other teams are slowing down scoring. When you're doing it in your scouting system, and we'll talk a little bit more about how we evaluate that. And you want to think about different ways of preventing scores. So one of the things that we actually focused on at Chezzy Camps just a couple weeks ago was actually keeping teams from getting into the what's the alley called? Secret passage to pick up balls. So we were actually parking our defender just at the top of the secret passage so they could not get back to get balls, and it worked extremely well. And then you also need to think about where the protected scoring zones are. So this year it's out, if you sit on the outer works, it's very hard to defend that. And so those are the kinds of things that you need to think about when you're looking for defenders. Are they aware of those kinds of restrictions on defense? So next slide. So we have, in our first pick robot, one of the things is that, and Brian will talk about this in our app, this is a screenshot from our scouting app that is on our phone that we use in order to pull up our data. So this is a screenshot from our pick order in the Hopper division of World Champs, because 148, I guess, is at the top of our list. So we have this information that's being updated throughout the match. The scouting app pushes our first pick order out all the time, so we always know what's going on with our first pick order and with our second pick order. And what we're looking for is a robot that best complements our strategy. This year there wasn't much conflict between robots, the first pick robots. They could pretty much do the same thing. But in 2014, we actually had a case where we were playing in the midfield and needed a robot that could finish and score goals. That's what the way we scored. 2013, when we had Ultimate Ascent and we were shooting frisbees, our best strategy actually was to have a full court shooter, and that we were had ground pickup and we could pick up the frisbees and score any of the missed shots. So those are the kinds of things that we're looking for. Complementarity, we're also looking for reliability. We want robots that consistently can make it through the matches all the way through, so we're counting reliability. We're looking for consistency. We don't want a lot of variation from match to match. We want, if we have a robot that's going to score 6 high goals in every match, we want that over a robot that will score 8 in some matches or 2 in other matches. And also being versatile. That is that if something happens in the match where they need to turn around and switch up their strategy, that they're able to actually do that. So for example, if their shooter breaks, are they effectively able to go back onto defense and actually be a very effective defender? So those are the kinds of things that we're trying to look for in our first pick robot. Next slide. Now our second pick robot is usually one where we're looking to fill the gaps of what we're not going to get out of our first two robots. Likely, that second robot is not going to be in a role of scoring points during teleop. But they're more likely playing defense or having the other complementary task is that's going on during during the teleop period. So what we do is we actually calculate what's called a value-added premium for our second robot, and we do the ranking based on that. What we do is we ignore all the scoring in teleop, and we only account the autonomous points and the end game points, the last whatever's happening in the last 30 seconds of the game, like climbing or challenging. And then we roll in our defensive, qualitative defensive ranking, which I'll talk about in a minute. And that's the way we do our second pick robot. So we're not looking for a robot that, for example, this year, we don't care if our second robot is able to shoot high goals. That was not one of the things that we were looking for, which some teams do look for that, but that's not something that we were looking for. We were looking for these other attributes that really supplement what's happening with our first two robots. And then as I'm going to talk about next is that the driver ability is really the core of how we define defensibility. For a robot. Next slide. It's trying. So our intended results that we want to get out of this is a robot that functions with good synergy. Oh, there we go. So as I said, we're looking for our first pick, a robot that's not going to compete with us for scoring objectives. And the second robot is going to be versatile, a good defender, and can respond flexibly to changing situations. And we may even use them for things like counter defense, so they may actually be working against defending robots in some cases. Next slide. So what we do is we think about every robot action that we can quantify or rank in some way. So we actually have a pretty extensive list of different actions that we look at. And even we have ways of looking at the question of how multiple robots interact with each other. So like in 2014 when they had the assist, we were actually looking at how does the assist work between robots. And we want to basically, as I said, think about setting up our scouting so we're looking for the most effective elimination alliance in the competitions that we expect to be in. Let me go to the next slide. So what we do try to do is actually keep the data collection pretty simple. So we're not trying to get our scouts to do really fancy things. So we've seen some apps, for example, where they actually have the scouts track where the shots come from on the field. They have a way of trying to do that. We tried to do that, and we found that the inaccuracies were so large that it wasn't worthwhile for us to collect. And it also became too much of a burden on the scouts to keep really complex data. So it's really, what we found is really important to keep it down to something like just the buttons, some kind of set of buttons, and not too many buttons for them to follow. The data needs to be easily understood by the scouts and to the drive team that are using the data. We need to be able to define it clearly for the scouts, and it's really got to be observable, easily observable on the field. You can't have something that's just too subtle. Ultimately, we actually also use ordinal rankings, and we'll talk about that in a minute, about how we use that in our defensive rankings. We have two different sets of metrics that we're measuring. The first one is a set of quantitative measures, which most of you are familiar with. It's just this mostly standard offensive statistics, so the goals scored, defenses crossed, anything that we can count. So that's one of the things we're just looking for. Yes, they've gone over that, hit that button, count those points. Then we also have a set of qualitative attributes that we're looking for. And that's more subjective, but what we do is go about doing it in a way where we can have a transparent ranking method between robots so that it's not so difficult for the scouts to carry out the qualitative analysis that they do. In this case, what we measure is we have ways of ranking driver ability between robots, things like evasion and speed, or their ability to be played defensively, like blocking some of the robots. And we're looking for some specifics about the robots themselves. So is the robot have a particular ability to accelerate or to push other robots? Next slide.
Hey guys, there's two seats here if you want.
So what we found is the quantitative data is fairly easy to gather and analyze. I think you would all find that generally in your scouting. But what we also have is the qualitative data. So what we do is we want to make the qualitative data, we want to gather it in a very consistent way. And we want to be able to then convert it into a quantity metric that we can match it up with our quantity data, merge them together so that we can get an overall ranking for each of our robots. And one of the things that we do is we go through and we weight the qualitative data, the relative value of the qualitative data compared to the quantitative data.
Next. Just one note. So by consistent, gathered in a consistent manner, that means that we don't have scouts like rotating through, especially those who are collecting qualitative data, because then we're going to have this very diverse mix of kind of opinions about things. We have just a couple that are very experienced, like FRC students, very experienced scouts, and understand how to, you know, measure a robot's ability to play defense or whatever it may be.
So, and the other thing is that we have count what we call abstract values. So, for example, one of the things that we counted this year, which doesn't necessarily transfer directly into points, is defense cost. So you only get defenses, you only count the first two towards points. After you cross a particular defense twice, it doesn't add anymore. But in fact, we were interested in the fact of, can a team cross a defense three, four, five times? Because that actually tells us that that team is will defeat that defense very easily. Rather than a team that just barely gets over a defense twice during a match, well, that team, their robot is probably not going to be as successful in crossing defenses as the first robot. So what we do is we think about those values of those abstract, or those abstract values, for example, how many times they cross a defense, and then we go through and we try to quantify the points that are attached to a number of crosses. And we go through some probability analysis of how likely is this robot to score 10 points on this defense because they can cross five times instead of crossing only two times. And that's one of these aspects that you want to think about when you're trying to count the number of observations. How do you convert some of that information into more quantitative data? Next slide. And then what we do is, the other trick we do is to convert our qualitative rankings into quantities. So we start by ranking robots by their driver ability or their defense ability. We only rank them against the other robots in their alliance. We don't rank them against the entire field. So many teams, they'll rank a team's defensive ability like from 1 to 5 or 1 to 10. And they tell their scouts to rank, to give that those robots a number that reflects where they place in the entire field that they're looking at. So if you're a champs, that's 75 teams. You're telling them to rank how they fit against 75 other teams and to keep that in mind for every single match. So what we do is instead, we have them only rank within the match they're watching right at that time. So either they're the first, second, or third best robot in the match. We don't ask them to do any more than that. And then what we do is, because of the way that you accumulate data over time, if a robot ends up as first in the match, every single match, they rise to the top of our ranking. Or if they're third every time in a match, they're going to fall to the bottom of our rankings. And it just happens that this is cumulative. By the way, you don't need to take a picture because you can get these slides off of our website.
Richard,
yeah.
Can you clarify? Because there's six robots on the field.
Right. So they're only doing within their own alliance. They're not ranking against the other alliance. We're only ranking inside the red or inside the blue. They are not ranking. What we do, we have two scouts, right. We have two super scouts. One scout looks at the blue alliance, one scout looks at the red alliance. They don't need to look across. And so in this way, what we're able to do is end up, we add a statistical analysis at the end when we spread it across a normal distribution, which you can read our white paper about how we do that. But essentially, we use this property, it's called the translute property. If A is better than B, and B is better than C, then A is better than C. So we're using a little math logic here in order to come to our conclusion that if you find that across matches, that over time, that you can find the best robots by doing this ranking system. It's actually turned out to be quite robust over the last couple of years that we've used this type of ranking system. It's worked better than having this 1-to-5 ranking system, which tends to float. One of the things is that we found that scouts wouldn't consistently give robots the same ranking across matches. Next slide. So what we do is then we walk through a process of doing essentially a regression analysis or we use the solver function in Excel where we derive how much the value, what the qualitative ranking value is, how much of an impact on the final score comes from those individual ranking systems. And we start by using previous year's data in many cases in order to, there's actually correlation between the games in terms of the ranking abilities and the score impact. And so we're able to do some of that conversion, and then we update it as the season goes on. We're basically, in some cases, one event behind in terms of how much the value of a particular attribute is, but it's usually pretty close. And we're, and of course, the main thing is that it's really, our ranking system is relative to each other. It's not an absolute system. So it ends up working out pretty well in terms of us being able to identify our second pick robot using this system. Next slide. I'm trying to see if this one, I think it probably covered almost everything in this discussion, and you can read that slide. You can read these slides, they're of course posted on our website. And so then what we do is with our draft pick metrics, I think I've gone over this before, our offense is really about all of the offensive output that in the ways that you can score points. And our second pick is drawn basically the value added measure that we talked about, and focusing on driver ability, which is our main metric for defense. Next slide.
That's it for that.
So Brighton's going to talk about that. How do we take this concept and how do we implement it?
So first, does anyone have questions about the conceptual parts of this or the math? The math in detail will be all on our white paper. It's available on Sheet Delphi. So if you want to see the equation, you can go there. But just basic concepts. Okay, we can move on to the concrete stuff then. All right, so we are trying to build a system that is easy enough for scouts to use that they won't make mistakes in collecting data. We're trying to build a system that is robust at competition, that's not going to break down, you know, halfway through and give us only the first half of the competition worth of data. And then we want to build a system that's easy to troubleshoot, because inevitably, if you are writing a complicated software system, it won't go perfectly, especially not the first couple of competitions. You have to pull it again. Slow. Okay, so different teams have different kind of bandwidth or capability in terms of software. Our team's been working on this for a while, so we have a whole room of 3 to 5 active programmers just working on scouting the entire season. So as a result, we write like 7 apps each year. We have a whole lot of stuff going on, but this is very scalable. So you can, with fewer programmers and a smaller budget, although we actually have a really small budget, you can move it down to only, you know, a few scouts. You can simplify to, instead of using tablets and phones, maybe scratch the phones and just look at your data on a spreadsheet. Or scratch the tablets and just do the entire thing on a set of Google Sheets. My quick version of a scouting system that's low budget and simple to put together: get yourself a mobile, like a cell data modem, Ethernet to a laptop, set up a Bluetooth hotspot, since Wi-Fi hotspots aren't allowed in the stands. Set up a Bluetooth hotspot to connect to a bunch of other people on laptops. Now you have all of your scouts with internet access. They can enter data into a Google Sheet. Google Sheets automatically can graph data for you really easily. You can set up your calendar, your calculations all in that sheet. Pretty simple. So our team, we do use Nexus 7 tablets. We're expanding our system this year to about 20 scouts. So we're gonna actually downgrade a little bit, start using some Fire tablets because they're cheaper. And these tablets all communicate via Bluetooth hotspots. And then from there, the tablets will send data to a Firebase database. I don't know if some of you are familiar with that. If not, you should look it up. It's owned by Google. It's really, really nice to use. And the our server, just a little Python server, will do some math, and then we can see that data on our cell phones. So, software, Java for the Android apps. We use Android apps for the Scouts and for the Super Scouts. Did you actually talk about the difference between those?
No.
Okay, so I'll go over that. So we have six Scouts, one per robot, right? They collect the quantitative data Richard mentioned, and then two Super Scouts, and they collect qualitative data, one for the Blue Alliance, one for the Red Alliance. And that's what he was referring to with the rankings. The Super Scouts do those qualitative ranking for the comparative robots. Sorry, now that I should have mentioned that earlier. So those are all Android devices, Java, Swift language for iOS programming, that's for viewing the app on my iPhone, and then Python on the server. We haven't done a web app, but a lot of teams do web apps. They're good because they eliminate the need to write a separate app for viewing data on Android phones versus iOS devices. There are also some downsides, like you have to actually have an internet connection, which you usually don't at champs and sometimes don't at other competitions. So there's trade-offs to that. And then, like I mentioned earlier, if you want to have it go faster, simpler, fewer people, less cost, use spreadsheets. So these are just some more screenshots. This is the same app, the Android version on your left and the iOS version on your right. We're searching through the match schedule here for our team number, and it just shows all the matches with us in it. But these apps really are created based on what your strategist or drive coach needs, whoever is looking at data in the middle of the competition, and if you want to use them for pick lists, whatever is required to have a fluid pick list conversation. So as these are developed, it's a constant process of talking to the end users. Cool. So, a few considerations for things to do at competitions. Before competitions, you may want to set up some match strategies. If you know the schedule ahead of time, you can set up, you know, I know from playing with Team 8, let's just use their example in the past, that they are really good at this defense and they've had trouble with this defense. And so I'm gonna preset up my strategy such that I have the, you know, so I'm playing to Team 8 strengths. And we use just like these paper printouts. Someone's kind of got to be the first one that makes them each season. So we've done that in the past. We've also stolen them from other teams, but usually people post them online at some point in the season. It's just a nice place to draw. And then we always scout a week one or a week zero event from our shop. So what we do is we set up a projector and we show the live stream, and all of our scouts sit there with the apps, which need to be completed, obviously, and they scout one robot. And we test to see if they can all get exactly the same data. And until they can consistently get the same data, scouting the same robot, we know that, you know, they're not ready yet, so we keep having them practice matches. So not only does this train our scouts, it's also a great way to systems test or integration test your scouting system. It's testing all the components together, making sure they work really well, and I honestly cannot stress enough how important it is to do a systems test, like, at least a couple of weeks before your first competition.
What was your server called again? Fire?
Oh, the database is called Firebase. Yeah.
Firebase, okay.
So, scout training on week zero. And then, of course, during season, like Richard mentioned, before a competition, you want to update those weightings of the qualitative values so that they match up with how much they should be worth quantitatively so that your pick lists come out right. We also sometimes do score predictions, partially just for fun. Sometimes it's useful for predicting seeding just before we have to talk about a pick list. That way we know who's likely to be an Alliance captain, or who's likely to move up into an Alliance captain position after picking happens, and we don't, you know, rely on them being there for us to pick. Cool. Okay, so we lay out our scouting team as such. We have a head scout. They do run a tablet, they scout data. They also are in charge of just managing people. So we have at least 8 scouts in the past. This year we're going to have 20 scouts. It's a significant logistical job, and it's really, that's the person that's really useful to have in close contact with, you know, your team captain or the people in the pits or whoever is moving your whole team around. Obviously, you need programmers if you have a software system. You need programmers at competition who are not engaged in some other job like operating or programming on your robot. Because when the scouting system breaks, you need someone available to fix it. Scouts, super scouts, I mentioned the difference between those two already. You have a strategist as of the last couple of years. Some of you may have gotten to know Colin last year. But that person uses the whiteboards that are based down there by Richard and draws out the map strategies. It looks a lot like that paper I showed you on a slide earlier, but it just goes on live at competition and they communicate with the tribe coach. So that person is actually one of those end users of the data that I mentioned earlier. They have the app in their pocket, on their phone, and they're looking at data and based on that, making decisions about how they should run the strategy. And then we also take videos of matches. We have someone who does that so that during picking, pick list creation, draft night, we can go and look at specific matches or specific instances to try to see what happened. And then we have mentors like Richard and often Mr. Harvey who have other logistical roles but also spend some time just watching matches and kind of understanding subjectively what's going on with robots or noticing things like, hey, this robot might not look so good in data because they started off really rough, but they've been fixing things and they got better over the course of the day. Okay, and yeah, do give your scouts breaks. They will be much more accurate if you do that. Thanks, okay. So, we do, like I mentioned, have mentors who watch the teams. We also have, especially the super scouts and those lead scout people who kind of give subjective input as to what future strategy might look like. We identify ahead of time what the difficult matches are. So say we're playing against 11-14, 2-5-4, and 9-7-1 all at once. We know that's gonna be a rough match. Probably pull it off, but I don't know. So we'll look at that match, we'll look really carefully, significantly ahead of time at who we're playing with on our lines, and just try to make sure we get everything out of it we possibly can. So say we know we obviously couldn't win that match, but we could still get the breach and the capture, right? So we could still get a couple of ranking points even if we don't win the match.
Yeah, our best story with that is we actually, the 2014 World Championships, we went to a match and realized we had 2 rookie teams in our match, one whose OPR was nearly 0. And so we knew on the plane flying to St. Louis, because we had identified the matches, that we needed to go help those rookie teams become better teams when we went there. So we actually dispatched team members to help their robots become better. And in fact, one of the teams went from being 0-10 at the regional to being 5-5. In the World Championship but that was specifically because we had identified a match where they were really important, and then we ended up winning the match because we lifted those 2 rookie teams.
So just because you're up against 11-14, 9-7-1, and 2-5-4, all is not lost. Actually, all is probably lost, but keep going. Okay. So we also have another special scout. A lot of teams do this at this point. It's called the pit scout. They walk around the pits, take down data like how many wheels. They take pictures of the robots. And the pictures are really the most critical part of the pit scout, because when we're talking about who we might want to pick, the night before we're gonna be picking out there on the field, it's really easy to forget, like, oh wait, what is that robot again, that has such and such number that you don't remember, or happen to know that robot by their name, not their number. It's really nice when every time you're looking at the data for a robot, you have a picture of it in front of you. So we have those photos go to Firebase, and then from there, they go straight into the apps. The Pit Scout also will look at things like team organization, what language did they use to program the robot in case their code breaks, can we help them, do our programmers know that language? And then we also have done what we've referred to it as cheesecake scouting. It's a specific skill that we want to see if a robot can do. So, let's see, last year we brought a little...
portable batter.
Yeah, we brought a portable batter around the pit, so it was just this plywood thing, and we tested, like, how well the cheese dealt with it, because sometimes, like, we don't always get to see the teams do everything on the field that we want them to do in our match. So we don't know if they can do it or not, and more importantly, we don't know if they can do it well enough or not. Like, they might say, oh yeah, we can get on the batter, but I mean, I think every team is familiar with, it's very easy to overestimate your own ability on the field. Our team does it all the time, just like anyone else. So it's good to have data when you're working on strategies about not just what they say they can do, but what they have shown they can do.
Yeah, can I just really emphasize what Brian's talking about there? Because every regional competition we've ever been to, there's a ton of teams coming around with sheets that students are asking for information about your robot. And I think, some of these teams, I think, are just training their students into understanding their robots, but I think some are actually trying to use this as data in their scouting. And so we don't do that at all. We don't ask questions. We do ask some questions,
but
if we're looking for a specific attribute, like Brian was talking about, we want them to actually show us that attribute in the pit. So inbounding was another thing. For example, in 2014, we didn't say, can you guys inbound? We said, here's a ball, show us an inbound in the pit.
Yeah. It's not as if we think anyone's lying, it's just we know that we do it. We know that everybody overestimates what their robot can do. It is just how things go.
And it's actually an opportunity to train your alliance partners or potential alliance partners in the future into doing something better. Because actually in 2014, very few robots had even tried inbounding. They were too busy trying to shoot balls in the high goal. And so when we came to their pit, we said, can you inbound? They go, no, we can't do that. Have you tried? And they go, no. And we said, okay, just shove the ball in the back of your robot and spit it out the front. They go, why would you do that? I said, because that's part of this whole strategy. We found tons of teams that could actually do that, but no one ever saw them on the field. So that gave us a huge advantage in scouting because we knew they could do it. And they would flow under the radar as a second pick.
That 1640 was playing as a high goal shooter as their first pick. And somehow they got overlooked as the first pick, and we had inbound tested them and knew they were an excellent inbounder. So we picked them.
Okay, so draft night, we create the majority of our pick list the night before, not during the morning before, the morning falls before you have to pick. It's because we really want time to discuss it and have a good conversation. So it's really critical that the scouting system and the data presentation method keep up with the pace of the discussion. If you have a situation where you're trying to talk about a team and it takes 30 seconds to pull up that team's data, then at that point you're probably no longer talking about that team. And it's kind of a moot point. So, if you can't use the data for your conversation, why have it at all? So of all the things to get right, make sure that the data viewing is designed such that you can actually view the data quickly. You want to include whoever's going to be announcing these picks in the process of deciding the pick list, just because from the perspective of that person, it doesn't feel great to be standing there. Say it's the team captain. It doesn't feel great to be standing there and have someone ask you right after you walk off the field, hey, why didn't you pick us, and not to have had any say in what the pick list looked like, or not to be able to say, there was a conversation about this, I'm sure you guys are great, but, good luck, it wasn't right for our alliance. To just be able to, to be in the position of going, I don't know, is not a good way to feel. So, include that person, include those strategic mentors, include maybe whoever is working on your scouting system and math as someone who can pull up data really quickly. But other than that, some teams try to have a really big scouting meeting. Our team likes it really small. it depends on how you want to run it. I know like 148 does, they have a lot of people and they run this really tight meeting where you kind of, you only like speak in a certain structure. You know, each student probably spoke 0 to 1 times. But it works really well because they get lots and lots of different opinions over the course of the night. Whereas we just have a few people, and so you can have a conversation, but maybe it's not as diverse of a set of opinions. So it depends on how your team likes to run things, but unless you have a really small group talking about this, you need to run a really, really tight meeting or it'll go all night. All right.
Which we experienced.
We did experience it going far too long, yes. And
bring in
avoid hive mind, avoid the kind of, there's a lot of different words for it, but the tendency to look at this one order and say this looks great and I'll start agreeing and then miss something that's better. So playing devil's advocate is important. And get food to go. This is a very specific, but don't waste time like eating at a restaurant first and then going back to have the pick meeting. You can eat while you're doing it, and especially as the night goes on, people become maybe less effective at having a productive discussion, less effective at remembering everything they saw during the day. You want to end that meeting as soon as you can, so you want to eat first. Eat during. Okay, so I mentioned earlier, we try to predict what the rough seating order is going to be, so that, you know, we can kind of count out teams that we know will be in a picking position or will be picked. We are also looking at, you know, who's going to end up pairing up and how we can build an alliance that's going to be capable not just of being a strong alliance in general, but of specifically defeating the other, you know, strongest alliances in eliminations. Rich, do you have a good historical example for this?
Well, that was actually the fruit of our first time that we did this type of draft system in 2013 at on Curie Field. We're famous for getting turned down by 4 teams before the fifth team accepted our draft offer. Well, we actually saw that they were going to turn us down, and we knew that ahead of time that we were actually breaking up potentially very powerful alliances, and it set it up better for us to be able to win the division. So we anticipated that happening.
So yeah, just because you think someone will turn you down, that doesn't mean you don't ask them. Because if they say yes, then great, you have a powerful alliance. If they say no, then you're making it more difficult for other powerful alliances to work. It is a good strategy. Okay, next slide.
Whoops.
Okay, so yeah, predicting seating order, we talked about this. If you do the math right, you can predict match outcomes pretty well. Here are a list of first picks. So that includes, that's just an ordered list of who we want as our first pick, and that needs to be long enough such that if, you know, every single team on that list by some chance gets picked first, like there's enough that there's no way all of them can be picked. And then second pick, the same thing. It has to be long enough that there's no way we can get, you know, have every single one of those teams crossed off. So it's not necessarily every team in the competition that you have to put in this order list, but it is actually a sizable chunk of that if you want to guarantee something on there. And then counter picks, yeah, again, thinking about what the other powerful alliances will look like and forming an alliance to counteract that. Okay, yeah, destroy all the non-final lists. Please, let me say it again. Destroy all the non-final lists. Make sure the only list your captain or whoever's picking has is the final list. And do have a list for each, you know, if you have multiple scenarios or you're thinking about how robots will perform the morning before picks, right? So you made your pick list the night before. If you have multiple scenarios, keep these organized. Destroy them when seating is over. And then have 2 or 3 people who are really experienced with not only this game, but just FRC in general, if you can, who are adjusting these slowly just by watching matches and saying, oh, this team's doing better today than they were yesterday. And maybe moving them up a couple of spots. So lessons learned. Yeah, we've done a lot of scrapping scouting systems. That happens. Things like heat maps, or essentially trying to track the location that robots do certain actions, Richard mentioned, were really ineffective for us because scouts just weren't accurate enough at tracking it for it to be a useful data point. And it took them so long that they would, you know, make mistakes on other data. We have been using Bluetooth. It's been a little bit rough, but we've got it kind of under control now, and our code is on GitHub, so if you want Bluetooth communication code, you can see ours. But it's a good way to communicate between tablets, since Wi-Fi hotspots aren't allowed and cables get really messy. The server is generally the thing that has the most problems because it's the developed. You spend kind of the most time developing. You often develop it closer to the competition than any other app, and the other one you'll finish and say, I'm not touching. The server you need to kind of keep changing as your strategists, you know, realize new things about the game. Maybe they're watching off-season events, making changes. So it's really critical of all the apps to have the person who is able to fix the server on hand at all times. At least that was our experience. Real-time data upload, super useful. Like we talked about earlier, we need our strategists to have access to the data to know what teams not just think they can do, but have done. So that's been important, but it is tough. Firebase is a great way to get around that because it is automatically real-time. It deals really well with lack of internet competition and automatically updating anytime you have internet. It's great. And then scout practice / systems test or integration test if you're a programmer. Having that week zero, week one event, it can be really fun. Our team spends the entire day doing it. We have like a pancake party, and we bring a bunch of pancakes and syrup and have all the scouts eat food and scout matches, and they'll scout like 50 matches maybe over the course of the day, and then they become great scouts. So in the end, yeah, system isn't perfect. We've definitely overridden, especially in small tweaks, the order that's spit out by the system. That's why you have a draft meeting, because you're not gonna just use this list that your map spits out. You're gonna move teams up and down a little bit. And yes, computers need sanity checks, math needs sanity checks. Don't ever just have one person writing the calculations. Check them. I remember in 2015 at our first regional, we had some calculations that literally we forgot to deal with the case where not all the matches have been played. And so, you know, the averages were like, why are the averages so low? Well, it's because all of the future matches are zeros. So do sanity check things. All right, so this coming year and in the future, we're looking to quantitatively measure scouting accuracy. We're doing a few different things, including pairing scouts up, having them watch the same robot, and noticing who most often selects data that doesn't agree with the other two scouts. We can also kind of calculate how close we can take the alliance score that's posted by like the Blue Alliance and take all of the actions that all of our Blue Alliance scouts submitted and add up the point values for those and see if they agree. So that's another way you can kind of like get an estimate of how accurate your scouts are. And then we've also started doing a little bit of eliminations scouting, so we know we're informed about map strategies that will be most effective against the people we play in the finals and the semifinals. Not doing anything complicated, just maybe 4, 5, 6 people using some just paper forms because it's very, very little data. And then we started recording matches, recording the videos of matches, and just name them with, hey, this is 2-3, it has these 6 teams in it, and then you can quickly search it up, and in 2 seconds you have a video of the match you're talking about on draft night. All right, so I'm not even gonna.
That's from Moneyball.
Yeah, if it's a fun movie, quote. It makes sense.
I think we're going to require people to watch Moneyball before they come to the workshop.
No.
And with that...
Yeah, thank you. I want to open up the Q&A for as long as we can before we're kicked out and have to go back to matches. So any questions about any of the things we just discussed?
I want to ask, first question is, how many of you are going to Madtown? How many of you? Anyone else? Because we're not going to have our scouting system running at that. Like that match, we'll be doing some. We'll be doing what we did in probably. Are we? Ever?
No, we don't have scouting here. We will have the full 20 scout system at Madtown.
Okay, great. So we're going to have it there. You're more than welcome to come by and see our scouting system in action. We're also available if you want to come and have us sit with you while you're scouting and talk with you about how you're doing it. We're more than happy to do that as well. So I want to make those kind of offers for that.
Also, of course, you can, so all of the code we use is from this past season, is available on GitHub. Our white paper goes into extensive detail. It's on Chief Delphi about mostly everything we just talked about and more. And yeah, we're happy to help. You can, of course, also email either of us, or you can email our team email, which is frc1678@gmail.com. You can go onto our website and submit to the contact me form. There's lots of ways. We definitely want to talk with you. All right. Any questions? No?
Can I ask a question of the whole group here?